a scientific analyst on NASA's PACE mission. And if you've never heard of PACE before, that's good. In this talk, as Stacey said, I'm going to be telling you all about the mission, what it is, how it fits into NASA's super broad range of activities, and what we're already learning from it as it reaches its 160th day in space. So I've split this talk into four big questions that I figured some of you might have. Hopefully by the end of this, you'll have an answer to all of them. Let's start with the first question, which I included here to build some fundamentals for you. This little intro should make the rest of the presentation a lot more easy to understand. So the basis of my job and what I got my degree in is a concept called remote sensing. In the broadest of terms, remote sensing is just getting some type of information about an object or a phenomenon without actually being in contact with that thing. So technically all of us are actually remotely sensing right now by looking at your screen with your eyes and hearing me with your ears. But in the context of Earth observation, we use satellites as our eyes instead. As the Earth gets hit by all of that good sunlight that we know and love, some of that light bounces off different surfaces on the ground and right back out into space where the satellite sees it. You can kind of think of it like a camera in space. We then get those pictures back from the satellite that the satellite took of Earth and kind of can dig into them to do some fun science, which I'll get to a little bit later in this presentation. So this diagram here is just showing you the incident solar radiation coming in from the sun, bouncing off the buildings, the roads, the grass, the water, the trees, and back up into the satellite. And then we can get that data down from the satellite to a server and get pictures like you see on the right there. So now you might be thinking that's all well and good, but don't you work at NASA? Isn't NASA supposed to look into space and not at Earth? And that would be a really fair comment. A lot of folks don't think that Earth is one of the planets that NASA even studies. But actually, NASA has a long history of Earth observation. So this animation here is just one example of Earth science that NASA's been doing since 1997, showing us how the chlorophyll concentrations in the ocean and the greenness of vegetation changes from month to month and year to year. But that's not even as far back as it goes. There are actually missions that go all the way back to the 70s. I'm thinking of one called Landsat specifically. So the Earth has clearly been a priority for NASA for quite some time. And this animation goes pretty long. It actually, I think it goes all the way up to 2015, but you can kind of see as the seasons change, the greenness shifts, there's ice at the poles that comes down and up as the Earth gets warmer and colder throughout the years. So you kind of get the idea. We can skip the rest of it. I included this slide just to show you all how many Earth-focused missions NASA has been involved with, even just since 2000, and how many more are actually planned into the future. So at the bottom there, you can see it goes all the way to 2030 and beyond. Now, the important one for today is called PACE. We launched February 8th of this year, and I was actually very fortunate to get to attend that launch. Feels like a lifetime ago now. And we also just started releasing data in early April, which has been super exciting to be a part of. So you see that PACE is just one small satellite in a long line of Earth observation missions. And just to note, there are so many different satellites because each one is specialized for a different purpose. So we've got lots of different things on this planet, right? As I said, buildings, concrete, grass, trees, you name it, we have it. And they all respond differently to different types of light. So you have infinite observing possibilities, and one satellite isn't going to be able to see everything that you want to see. So now that we have that good bit of background about satellites and NASA, let's move on to the fun stuff that I love. I can start telling you about PACE now. So PACE stands for Plankton, Aerosol, Cloud, Ocean Ecosystem. Now, I'll give you a little bit of a disclaimer right now. As Stacey said previously, the presentation I'm about to give you about PACE is probably very different from a presentation that you'd get from any of my colleagues. If you see the title of the slide and the presentation, they all have land in parentheses. Land wasn't actually included in the original mission name because they weren't sure they were going to look at land data from the satellite until a little over a year ago, pretty much right before launch. And that's when I was hired, which I'm grateful for. Now my job on the mission is to worry about all things land. So there's a lot of talk about terrestrial science in these next few slides, and that's because that's what I work on for PACE. There's actually a little joke around the lab that the mission should have actually been called PLACE instead of PACE, but anyway, let me tell you about the actual satellite. The important stuff to know here is that PACE is a satellite or observatory, and on that satellite, we have three instruments. So we've got the ocean color instrument, called OCI for short, HARP-2, and SPEX-1. OCI is the instrument I work with primarily, so I get land stuff from an ocean color instrument. And that's also the one that I'll be focusing on for the rest of my slides, just because I know it the best. HARP2 and SPEX1 are what are called polarimeters. So they're different types of instruments than OCI. And not only can they take pictures in a number of different wavelengths, but they can also look at they can also take pictures of different angles as well, and also different polarizations of light. This allows folks to do some really cool 3D work, like reconstructing clouds. I also forgot to mention, OCI is an instrument that can take pictures in about 290 different colors. It's really cool science that we're doing here. So PACE's ultimate goal as a mission is to study Earth and all of its diverse ecosystems, right? To characterize how our planet is changing daily, monthly, and even yearly on those timescales and on those bases. We're hoping that the data will be applied by scientists all over the globe to study their environments and help make decisions easier for farmers and fishery owners and better management for land and all that good stuff. So given that I just showed you decades of previous satellites launched with NASA's help, you might be wondering what's so special about PACE that I would want to present it to you today. Well, this slide should speak to that. Just from the figure right there, you can see some differences between the left and the right panel, right? Even if you know nothing about lighter satellites, you could assume that a whole rainbow is better than little chunks of it. And that's basically what is revolutionary about PACE. So older satellites, like one called SWIFT, MODIS, and VIRS, they're what we call multispectral satellites. They're fantastic instruments. I've used them many times before, but they can only see about at most 36 different colors in the case of MODIS. And for others, it's like 25 different colors or less. And I mentioned before that OCI can see about 290 different colors, which makes PACE what's called a hyperspectral satellite, excuse me. So if you think back to when you or your kids used to play with crayons, that's like the difference between a small 16 pack with a limited set of colors and a huge 96 pack with the attached crayon sharpener, which always made me feel like really fancy, and you know, it was very fun to have that. So basically PACE is able to see a lot more nuance as it goes around observing the Earth than you would just be able to with, you know, 36 or 25 different bands. So we can see a lot more detail, just like you would make more detailed drawings with more different colors. So what can we do with all this detailed data that we're seeing now that PACE has been in space for as long as it has been? Well, we can do a whole lot. PACE is an extremely multidisciplinary mission, as I said, which supports ocean science, atmospheric science, terrestrial science, coastal science, disasters. The data we're producing is applicable across the globe. So the pie chart on the left there is a numerical breakdown of who initially is going to use PACE data. And we expect these numbers to kind of shift around and even out as the mission gets more mature and other communities see potential in PACE for their own projects. And you'll see that we, as in land people, only have a small piece of that pie currently where that star is slowly showing up. And that's because PACE isn't optimized for terrestrial science. As I said earlier, we weren't even sure that we were going to get land data from PACE. But now that we are, I can tell you a little bit about the specifics of my job. So let's dive into how PACE is being applied for terrestrial science. So you've probably all seen satellite data before a bunch of times, like in commercials, or I know Google has that like screensaver where they just kind of show you different pretty images from satellites. The news uses satellite imagery often in any number of places. And typically, they're really nice bird's eye view images of a place that you care about or that you're interested in, like this one on the screen. This was a nice clear day in June for folks in the Midwest, United States, and Southern Ontario. And the only thing you're really able to tell that this is an image from a satellite is the clouds over the East Coast, right? And just the scale at which this picture was taken. Like, it's clearly not from an airplane or anything like that. But if we look more closely, you can start to see that the image is a little dark. There's like some weird artifacting. I don't know if it's showing up as well for you as it does for me, but it's a little pink at the edges. It just looks a little weird. It's not as clear as it could be. And that's because by virtue of this image being taken by a satellite, we have a whole bunch of atmosphere between the ground and the sensor. So if you think back to like hazy summer days or even just days from last year with all that wildfire smoke, you know that the atmosphere can block a lot of light, and that's what's happening with the satellite. So it's seeing everything from its lens that's, you know, at the top of the atmosphere, down through the atmosphere and to the ground. So it's kind of the atmosphere is messing things up a little bit for us. So a big part of my job is to remove that atmosphere, because as a terrestrial scientist, my community is interested in how materials on the ground actually reflect the incoming sunlight, not what's in between it. So this image is the exact same as the previous slide, just corrected for atmospheric effects. And if we go kind of back and forth a little bit, You can see that everything starts to look a lot brighter when you correct for the atmosphere, and the colors look a lot more like how they would if you were seeing them from the ground. And that's because we've effectively removed the interference from those pesky gases and aerosols that our atmosphere is made out of. And this type of data is called surface reflectance data. And it's the basis of like 99.9% of what I do on a daily basis. Oh, and as a side note, this is one of my favorite slides. You can make some really cool color composite images with surface reflectance that are completely qualitative, but are kind of able to give you a sense of what's actually on the ground. Like this one, that's again made with the same exact data as the previous images, but displayed using a false color composite scheme, which is supposed to emphasize vegetation. What this means in total basic terms is that I'm essentially telling my screen or my monitor, okay, out of those 290-ish different colors that OCI took this image in, display the image in a way that makes vegetation look red. Because you know, every different type of material on the ground reflects all of those different colors differently. So you can kind of pick and choose which wavelengths you want to emphasize in images like this. Then when you're looking at the image, you would expect any areas with a lot of plant cover to be red because that's what I told the monitor to do. And because we're at the scale with OCI, it's at the top of the atmosphere, right? You're seeing a big chunk of the United States and North America as a whole. Almost everything fits into the vegetation category. But if you look a little bit more closely, I hope it's showing up for you on your screens. There are small gray patches that are actually representative of cities and concrete. And these show up differently because concrete and plant matter reflect light differently. So you can already draw a whole lot of conclusions about the ground just by looking at data visually in these different ways. And pretty pictures are all well and good, but as I said, these are really qualitative ways of examining satellite data, and I tend to work a lot more quantitatively, so numbers and all those good things. So this is an example from a poster I presented recently, and basically these plots are just showing you what was under the hood of each pixel in those pretty pictures that I just had on screen. In other words, each plot is showing the surface reflectance at each color of light or wavelength of light for a single pixel, which is represented by those stars there in each image, as opposed to showing you one color for every pixel over the entire image. And that was what those pretty pictures were previously. So each of the solid lines is a hyperspectral sensor measurement. And I also included a multispectral sensor measurement represented by those red dots to demonstrate how much more information we can get from missions like PACE. These lines, or what we call spectra, are such different shapes because they're representing very different things on the ground. So the plot on the left is of sand in the Sahara, and the plot on the right is of vegetation in Spain. And you can see that it would be much more difficult to differentiate these two ground cover types with multispectral data, again, those little red dots. But it's incredibly easy with hyperspectral data. So, you know, you can clearly see that there's a difference with the little red dots, but it's a lot harder to kind of fit those differences. But when you have a whole solid line running through that, you see they're very different. So doing some more math with surface reflectance spectra, as I said, it's 99% of what I use. We can even get beyond just vegetation and sand to metrics called vegetation indices. There are approximately a billion vegetation indices out there, and everybody has their favorite. And most of them just get at specific features of what's actually on the ground. So, for example, we can say things like, okay, we know there's vegetation here, but how healthy is that vegetation really? And then you would calculate something called NDVI to estimate that. And NDVI stands for Normalized Differentiated Vegetation Index. They're all super wordy. We love abbreviations in remote sensing. And you know, as a scientist and a science communicator, I am trying my best to get away from that, which is why I spelled them all out for you on the screen. So if you wanted to look at vegetation health, it's NDVI. If you wanted to look at how much water stress a plant is under, you could use NDWI, which is Normalized Difference Water Index. More specific, or more recently, some really smart folks have come up with specific hyperspectral indices to get at even more specific aspects of vegetation. So each plant has different amounts of pigments in them. So there's an index rather called the anthocyanin reflectance index that you could calculate to get at the relative amount of that pigment called anthocyanin in a plant. And that would tell you how protected the plant is from the sun. These are extremely important, especially, I mean, if you've just been living in the world this summer with this heat, you know, it's very important to know how plants are doing when it's a sustained 95 degrees out, at least in Maryland, if this is what it's been. So yeah, we can use vegetation indices to get at that. And the gray area here is no data because we can't see through clouds in the visible spectrum, which is where OCI looks. So these indices are also most useful when we can look at them over a period of time called a time series. So this is a time series of another index called the chlorophyll index red edge that gets at the relative chlorophyll content in plants. And that goes from, I think this was created from April to May. I think I made it right after we started releasing data. And you can see how much the chlorophyll changes just on a daily basis. If I go back and forth again, you can kind of see the cycle. When it goes more dark green, that means there's more chlorophyll in the plant. When it goes more red, yellowy, that means there's less chlorophyll in the plant. And this kind of study is completely unique to PACE, especially for terrestrial science. So we're super excited to start investigating this and to understand what it means for everything from our forests to our farmland. And of course, I would be remiss if I didn't mention some of the other incredible things that my colleagues are working on. We'll start with ocean products, since that is PACE's primary mission. In the left panel of the image, you can see a true color composite for an OCI image, which is, again, the surface reflectance. So they use it as well. And it's very similar to what I showed you over land before, just for a different picture. And then on the rightmost panel, you can see a visual representation of chlorophyll concentration, which is similar to what I just showed you with the vegetation index, all that concept, but a little bit different because it's ocean. Basically, it's how much chlorophyll is in the water. The red areas are higher chlorophyll, the blue areas are lower chlorophyll. And this, there would be chlorophyll in the water due to like algae, phytoplankton kind of deal. Both of these things you can do with multispectral data from previous sensors as well. What's special about this image is the middle panel. So those greens and pinks are from an algorithm created by my colleagues that is using hyperspectral ocean color data to determine the exact type of phytoplankton present in the ocean. So just like you have different types of trees, like an oak or a willow or those kinds, there are different types of phytoplankton as well. And this is totally unique to PACE. Again, typically people have to actually physically get water samples, like go on a boat and scoop some water up and look at it under a microscope to actually determine the species of phytoplankton. But right now we're at the point where we can get this information for across the globe from satellites in space. And finally, I'll tell you briefly about the atmosphere, which is another key discipline for PACE. All three of PACE's instruments are useful in atmospheric remote sensing. They're interested in pretty much the opposite of what I'm interested in. So they want to look at all the things I told you I removed from an image to make those surface reflectance plots. They want all of that information. So PACE data will be able to inform measurements of quantities like aerosol optical depth, which can be likened to the thickness of aerosols in the air. Again, those smokes, those hazes, all that stuff that happens when there's an event like a wildfire or, you know, like a sandstorm as well. These types of measurements are super important for air quality metrics, and they affect all of us. So with PACE, we're hoping to be able to track these high optical depth areas and better prepare people living in and around them for potential breathing hazards. And this slide is full of very cool algorithms in the atmosphere that I wish I could explain to you, but my colleagues could do a much better job at that. So with all that being said, thank you so much. And before I end here, I just want to say a huge thanks to Morgane McKibben, Jeremy Wardell, Fred Humrick, Aaron Urquhart, and everybody at the Ocean Ecology Lab for doing such a great job on PACE and for making the Ocean Ecology Lab a fantastic place to do science. And yeah, I'm happy to answer any questions that you guys might have.